We are diverse. We are different people. I speak a different language from you, but I love you. I care for you. If something happens to you, I'm there. And I will not impose on you to do something according to my whims and fancies, and I don't expect you to do something according to my whims and fancies, etc. I don't need to. Someone chooses not to be a Muslim, Allah says, وَقُلِ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. The truth has come from your Lord. Whoever wants, they should believe. Whoever wants, they can disbelieve. And they, whatever action anyone does, they will face the consequences with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, لَا إِكْرَاهَ فِي الدِّينِ قَدْ تَبَيَّنَ الرُّشْدُ مِنَ الْغَيِّ. There is no compulsion when it comes to entering the fold of Islam. You cannot force someone to enter Islam. You cannot compel people to enter the fold of Islam. If they want to choose not to enter, they are free to do that. Subhanallah. That's the verse of the Quran. I cannot shove down someone's throat to accept what I believe. It's up to them. They need to answer to Allah. They will give the answer to Allah. All religions believe. The Christians believe that whoever doesn't take Jesus as their personal savior will go to hell. Literally. They believe he has no chance. That doesn't make them extreme people. So when the Muslims say, if you don't believe in Islam, perhaps you won't have a chance in the Akhirah. Well, it's just like what the Jews say as well. That if you don't belong to this group, that's it. You have nothing for you in the hereafter. These are matters of belief. Everyone is free to believe what they want, and they are free to propagate it in a beautiful way. It's a human right. That's what it is. If you don't know the human rights, go and find out. Subhanallah. But in the same way, you have the right. He says he is the owner of the devil. What is the crisis? In man's no chance, this woman's going straight to hell. Are you the gatekeeper of hell? May Allah forgive us. Be careful of deviance. It is deviance, no matter what they talk around, spreading war amongst people. The Muslim, we need to stop it. How do we stop it? By learning community who talk. You will categorize them immediately. This one only talks about other people, and they only, another one, he never talks about others. Right and what is right. Is extreme, and who is teaching you that which is good. That alayhi wasallam says, khayrul umuri awsatuha. The fair is the middle path. That which is in the center. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from another extreme. Some people will tell you, how do I fit in? Yes, I fit in. I talk to people. I greet the people. I respond to the greetings of the people. I respond. I will smile. I will reach out. I will help. I will contribute to community, society. I will contribute to my name. I will make sure I am a citizen, because we all from different countries. These are not Muslims. How? Well, why are you living here then? Subhanallah. Why are you staying here? You want to live here, you will uphold the law. The reason is, you have to contribute, whether it's your taxes, whether it's everything else, and even if it's voluntary, you will contribute. When the nation is struggling, you will stand up as a citizen of the nation, and you will help and assist, because that's what it is. Like I've said in my previous talks in this beautiful series known as Building Bridges, that when calamity strikes, all the lines and barriers drop, you become a human being. Human being, I'm a human being, and so is everyone else. And the way we say this, my beloved brothers and sisters, when someone is struggling, suffering, someone's life is at stake, a Muslim is taught to save that life. A Muslim is taught to help save the life, not to leave it, not to ask them, hey, what are you? What's going on? Etc. As much as I may not be gay, if someone is dying, he's drowning, he's suffering, and he happens to be gay, I will help him to come out. It does not give me the right to kill the man just because he is gay. Not at all. Remember this. He's a human being at the end of the day. And if I was drowning, guess what? He would probably dive in to take me out. Will I say, no, 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 let me dive back because you are gay. Dive back in. Let someone else come. No. You need to think what is being said. I'm not talking from fresh air. I'm giving you sound knowledge to tell you how sacred human life is. Human life is. It is sacred. We need to know this. I'm speaking from the pulpit of this house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to inform you, to let you know, my brothers and sisters, it's about time we understood how sacred life is. And yes, there will be people who hate us. There will be people who dislike us. But we've got to do something. Someone hates you, they dislike you. I dislike them as well. I dislike of expanding the problem. You have not been a part of the solution. But if you want to solve that matter and that problem, then my beloved brothers and sisters, you will understand this person doesn't know what he is saying. This person doesn't understand. Let's educate them. So you reach out to them somehow. They might not want to listen to you initially, but if you sow the seeds of goodness, that tree will grow even after you have passed away. People say, what's going on? What's happening in the world? Look what's happening in the States. Look what's happening elsewhere. These people, they hate Islam. They hate the Muslimin. My brothers and sisters, calm down. Calm down. Seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Get up, do your work. Don't give up your faith just because someone said Islam is a bad religion. No. If that's the case, you were never a proper Muslim. But when you are identified as a Muslim, when you will face a little bit of persecution, because that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam predicted it already. The Quran says, "Wala tasma'unna min alladhina utul kitaba min qablikum wa min alladhina ashraku adhan kathira wa in tasbiru wa tattaqu fa inna dhalika min azmi al-umur." You will hear a lot of difficult words, a lot of verbal abuse, a lot of persecution that will come to you from people who belong to other faiths. But if you are patient and if you are God conscious, then that is the best thing you could do. In tasbiru wa tattaqu, you need to bear patience no matter what. Allah knows what happened to you is not even a fraction of what happened to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But what did he do? In Ta'if, he raised his hands after he was bleeding. He says, Allahumma ghfir li, Allahumma hdi qawmi, fa innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, guide my people. They don't know. They don't know what they are doing. So Allah says, bear patience. You will hear lots of bad words. Don't give up your faith. Bear patience. Still reach out. Because you want to show you are the bigger person. The faith you follow is far more humanitarian than any other faith. The Muslims who donate charities are by far the biggest percentage of donors of charities in the whole world. Did you know that? Go and find out. Go and see. Read about it. The Muslims who donate charities are by far the largest percentage of a single group of people who donate charities. That's because your religion has taught you to give. That's why. So keep giving. And keep giving to the right cause. Islam about being good to my neighbors. Until I your inheritance to your neighbor. You hear the hadith? The Prophet says, and the fulfillment of the rights to your neighbor. Jibreel alayhi salam had so many that I thought one day he's going to say, when you die, a share of your inheritance. Who are we talking about? The hadith. A neighbor, not a Muslim. That's your neighbor. Why? Because that the neighbor and the other neighbors make up a neighborhood. The neighborhoods make up a community, a society, a little suburb. The suburbs make up a city. The cities make up a country. The country, subhanallah, it will be strengthened if the relationship between the nuclear homes is strong. But when your relationship with your neighbor is nothing, no, he's not a Muslim, I don't need to know about him. No, inquire about him. Find out about their health. Find out about their needs. When they're going on holiday, the relationship should be such that they can give you the keys of their house and say, you know what, we're going out for 2 weeks. Please take care of this home. Wow. Not like nowadays someone does that to you when they come back, the house belongs to someone else. You sold it and you got the money and everything happened. And you went in and started pinching all the appliances. Wallahi, a Muslim should live such that they trust you so much with their belongings. When they're going, they bring their Ferrari to you and they tell you, look, I'm going to Harare, but you can keep my Ferrari for 2 weeks. MashaAllah. Subhanallah. And when they come back after 2 weeks, they find it exactly as it was. Not with the tire slashed and everything, the windscreen broken and everything else happened. No! May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. This is how we will fit in when we learn to fulfill the Islamic rights that have been delivered to the non-Muslims. They've given to the non-Muslims. And if you look at the fuqaha, the jurists, and how they've explained the rights of the neighbors, they say if a neighbor is a non-Muslim, he has the rights to be fulfilled. If he's a Muslim, he has double rights, because one is that of a neighbor, and two is the fact that he is your brother in faith, over and above being a brother and a sister of yours in humanity. Subhanallah. And if he's a relative, he has three rights. The first of being a neighbor, the second of being a brother in faith, and the third of being related to you. Imagine. It's explained. So at least fulfill the first rights. Take care of them. Look after. Greet. The neighborhood must be warm. You don't have a neighborhood that is very cold and dry. People walk and go. You know, people who live in high rises. Before, we used to know who's living on the second floor, third floor, who's living here and there. For the right reasons. Not because they have a pretty daughter. No. No. But for the right reasons. See, the youngsters know what I'm talking about, right? You greet the uncle every day in salah, not because you want to greet the uncle. You're eyeing his daughter. May Allah forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. And the day you hear she's married, you stop greeting the uncle. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So there was a time when we used to know all the people, we used to help the car park and all the common area, the water, the tanks, because we live in the same building and we all cooperate. Because when you cooperate, you will be able to lead a peaceful life yourself to begin with. But nowadays, high-rise building, you share the same lift, you go in, come out, people are frowning at each other, each one is on his phone or her phone. Subhanallah. And you didn't know that the girl you are dating online is actually your neighbor, you're in the lift every day. And you are in the lift saying hi, and she's replying hi. And she doesn't know it's you and you don't know it's her. May Allah forgive us. The world has become so antisocial with social media. The world has become so antisocial with social media. And this is why, if you want to know how antisocial a person is in real life, you just need to ask them, do you have Facebook? They say, yes. You have Twitter? Yes. You have Instagram? Yes. You have Google Plus? Yes. You have LinkedIn? Yes. You have, what else? WeChat? Yes. What else? Tell me a few things. What? You have WhatsApp? Oh, I can't forget that one, man. You have WhatsApp? Yes. You have Telegram? Yes. The minute they answer yes for all of those, you must know that there is a problem in the house. There is a problem with the children. There is a problem with the friends. They are very antisocial. They are sitting on the screen. But when someone visited me today and I asked them, are you on Instagram? They said, no. I said, Alhamdulillah, you don't need to be on it. And I'm sure you have a happier home than others. You don't need to be on it. Now you might think, hey, you being a hypocrite because you're on it. If you know how to use it and you are disciplined, by all means, it's a blessing. It's a good way of contacting people. I mean, WhatsApp is a big blessing, but WhatsApp becomes a pain when you go home and instead of hugging your children and kissing your wife and, you know, you're just on WhatsApp. As you enter the door, no one, you don't, you bump into them, your head bumps into them, and you just say, hey, and you're still on your phone. How? We've become so antisocial. You see? This is why now when I ask you, are you on Facebook? Please just tell the truth. Don't lie. Just say, yes, unfortunately I am. You know? What I am teaching you is discipline. I'm not saying give it up. I'm saying set aside the time. I will check my message from this time to that time. Tell your friends, if you urgently need me, phone me. Because I'm not going to be checking my WhatsApp messages throughout the day. As soon as you hear ting ting, ants in your pants. You can't sit down. You can't. You are scratching where it's itching. You need to pick your phone up and quickly check. Just because ting ting, that's it. You can't even sit for a second. It's like, khalas, revelation came to you from the heavens. Come on, relax. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Learn to fulfill the rights of others. Do not be antisocial. How can you fit in your society when you have not even thought about them? You don't even greet them. You don't even reach out to them. Subhanallah. They have a meeting in your community to decide law and order or to decide something that affects the entire community. Everyone attends, but the Muslims don't attend. Why? That's when people start looking at you and saying, look at these people. They don't want to attend. Go for the meeting. Go with your identity. Smile at the people. Greet them. Come up with good suggestions. Contribute towards it. Sacrifice a little bit. That is called da'wah. Da'wah actually means fitting in. That's what it means. You fitted in. You presented the deen without even talking to them. Subhanallah. But we don't participate. Why? These people are not Muslim. Well, when the trouble comes, don't blame me, blame yourself. Because when days were easy, you did not participate. Participate. Go out, let them see Allah has blessed you by putting people who belong to a different faith right next to you so that they can see how you live. Don't become closed such that no one must talk to me, no one must talk to my children, no one must talk to anyone. No, we have to change that. You have to speak. People think you're a terrorist. That's what they think you are. Change it. How are you going to change it? By showing them who you really are. Let them see your salah. When they hear the word Allahu Akbar coming from your house, they mustn't think that house is going to blow up just now. But that's what the media makes them think. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. We say Allahu Akbar a million times a day. You hear the adhan. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. How beautiful it sounds. What do you think is going to happen immediately after that? People are going to pray. That's what's going to happen. So when the non-Muslims hear Allahu Akbar and they say, don't worry, that's a call to prayer for the Muslims, then you know you've interacted correctly. But you've never told them what you were about. You never shared anything. You've never invited them into your home. No, these people are dirty. They can't come in here. Is your house a masjid or something? Even in the masjid, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to invite the Christians and the Jews and the others. Go and learn about al-wufud. A time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Masjidun Nabawi, the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, he called in some of these people in groups. They lived there, they stayed there inside the masjid. Do you know that? Go and read about it in the seerah. The problem is we don't. So when someone tells us, we look surprised. Hey, I think he's making a mistake. I think he doesn't know what he's talking about. No, I'm giving you facts. That's what it is. But we have become so closed that sometimes we are to blame. The bridges are burnt by us, not built. Go out and build these bridges. Reach out to the people. Inter-Muslim reaching out is very important as well. Someone belongs to a different sect. Be careful how you talk about them. You need to reach out to them. You need to understand they are human beings. You need to understand what you believe. You don't want to compromise it. So learn more about what you believe. You may want to discuss it with them in a him or her. That's what it is. The exact same maker. You look at the people of other faiths in your own nation. What do you have in common with them? A lot. But the strongest point is Allah, who you worship, that person was created by the same Allah. That is why they are sacred in terms of their life. The life is sacred because the giver of the life is the exact same giver of your life. Who entitles you to take it away? Who tells you take this life away? How? You follow? So look at them as family members, my brothers and sisters. From a distance, they are family. At the end of the day, we're all from Adam. And Adam is from Turab, from the dust. Subhanallah. If Allah wanted, He could have created Adam from gold, from silver, from platinum. But Allah says, no, man, I make you from dust for you to realize that you're all equals and you're all going to go back into the dust. That's what it is. The superiority complex that we suffer by, sometimes really, it destroys the bridges. There are people on the globe busy trying to build bridges and others are burning every bridge that is being built. Don't be from among the latter. Don't. So my brothers and sisters, today we've shared beautiful words. We have shared beautiful words and these words are connected to how to deal with the crises that we are facing. Every nation faces a different problem. There are unique problems in all different countries, different problems. Some countries are busy trying to ban Islam. Some are busy trying to ban the hijab. Some are busy trying to ban the beard. I don't think they're going to get there so quickly. But anyway, some are busy trying to ban whatever else. And some will probably want to ban Muslims completely. But I tell you, don't panic about it. Keep on building bridges. A day will come when the public of the same nation will say, no, we won't allow this to happen. We all have friends who are Muslims. That's what they will say. How many of you know non-Muslims? And how many of you have friends who are not Muslim? I'm sure everyone in the masjid will put up their hands. Well, you need to understand, if you do business with them or you do any dealings with them and you've reached out to them in your own little way, there are 5 or 10 of the friends. Well, the rest of them are deserving of your kindness just like those whom you know. Perhaps they know someone else who's a Muslim. Sometimes you hear, I've heard, some non-Muslims, some religious leaders belonging to faiths other than Islam. Sometimes I've heard their statements against the Muslims that are harsh, very hard. And you know what I think to myself? Sometimes they say, kill these Muslims, do this to the Muslims and harm the Muslims and do this to them and that to them. And I say, if your faith teaches you that, I want you to know that my faith does not teach me that. Subhanallah. If your faith teaches you to harm and kill and maim and destroy and burn and you know, cause harm, cause destruction, my faith does not teach me that. It teaches me to reach out to you and give you some water when you are thirsty. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. But sometimes people hear such fiery comments and they get fired up themselves. Subhanallah, there's no point of getting fired up. At the moment on the global level, we actually need to reach out to people. I tell you what's happening. The general non-Muslim masses across the globe are so curious to know more about Islam. Never in the history of the globe have there been such a large number of people really looking into Islam with a magnifying glass. So what has happened? It's given me an opportunity to reach out. Wallahi la an yahdi Allahu bika rajulan wahidan khayrun laka min humur an-na'am. The Prophet says, wallahi, is valuable in terms of conveyance. The red brothers and sisters, let's learn to reach out to people. Let's not in a bad way. People will do bad because we'll get up and do goodness. And don't think for a moment that we don't want to see solutions to the problems on the globe. We all would like to see solutions to what is happening in Syria. We want to see solutions to what is happening in Iraq. We are bleeding regarding what is over. And sisters, you've got to very deeply what the solution is, rather than just using your emotions, getting excited and going to make the problem bigger than it actually is. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless this ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a return to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala soften our hearts towards one another. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us realize that we need to live with the Muslims, the non-Muslims. We need to live with those who love us, those who hate us. And we need to try and reach out to all of them in one way or another. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ وَبَارَكَ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.